Good morning, church. We're ready to start. But before we do, just a couple of things. Number one, we just received a few weeks ago a thank you for supporting students like me. Sharon White. Sharon's husband is Jeff White. He's a pastor in Digby. But she says, dear congregation of Avonport Baptist, I have the... Yeah, I thought it was so loud. But that's because I got my hearing aid on this time. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, welcome everybody to our church service today. And just before we begin, just reading a card from Sharon White, who's a student at Acadia Divinity College. Her husband is Jeff White. He's the pastor at the Digby Baptist Church. Dear congregation of Avonport Baptist, I have the honor of sending you this thank you note for supporting ABC. Your donation helps in more ways than you may imagine. Not only does it help to, us students afford tuition costs, more importantly, you encourage us through stressful assignments, deadlines. I expect to graduate in 2022 and have recently accepted a call part-time to a local church. I pray for you all for your protection from the COVID virus and for your strength. May you be emboldened to continue sharing God's love through word and action in your community. Grecian peace to you all in 2021. Sincerely, licensed Sharon White. So I just wanted to share that. I know Sharon personally. She's a great lady. Works with the volunteer as a chaplain with the volunteer fire department in Digby. Great lady. Does a lot of likes helping people. Also want to take the opportunity to say thank you today to Mary Kinsman and to KK. Sterling. Kay Sterling. That's a Freudian slip. Mary Kinsman, would like to welcome you today, Mary. I understand that you are sought after throughout the valley in many ways. You've sung in many local Baptist churches. You're a member of the Centerville Baptist Church. You've also sung in fundraisers, harvest and Christmas concerts, and have been a featured soloist at the Eastern Valley Association on several occasions. So I really appreciate you being here today, and thank you, Ken, for reaching out to you. And appreciate having one of our own, Kay, playing the organ today. So thank you for that. Want to remind you of the Bible study on Tuesday at 2 o'clock, and also our coffee time with our men at the Brianna's Cafe Wednesdays at 10:30. Also want to call up Bill. Where's Bill? Bill, come on up and share with us.
Just to let you know that we have our heat pumps finally working. We have set a temperature. We've set the temperature on the one downstairs the same as up here. They've told us that to keep them all at the same temperature. Even though we've been turning the one down when we're not here and so on, they're suggesting or telling us that it's best to set them to where it's comfortable. Leave them alone. Let them run. The other thing that they suggested, even though the fire inspector tells us to keep the door down there closed and this one over here closed, they're hollow doors. If we had a fire, they'd only last for about 5 minutes. They burn a hole through them anyway. So what they're suggesting is if we leave the door open going to the vestry down there and this door over here open going to the vestry, pull the curtain back, let the air move around, and they'll keep the church at the same temperature all the time. If you find that the temperature we have it set at right now, you find it too warm, maybe with a little luck we can start taking our jackets off while we're in church. And if you find that the fans are too annoying when he's preaching, that's it, we can turn the fans down a little. But right now we've got them set on high, and it seems to be working all right, other than if it gets too noisy, then we can adjust and turn them down. So please let us know if it's too much fan, and we'll adjust that for next Sunday and see how that works out. It's quite a session to get these things hooked up. We finally got somebody here to do it, and hopefully we see a big savings in our power bill over the next year. The other thing is, we now don't need these two windows to open anymore, so we could use stained glass in them if somebody was interested in doing something like that, because in the summertime we can switch to air conditioning, so we don't have to open our windows. We still have the front entrance to replace. We still have this window up here to replace. It's all rotten on the outside.
Not replace the window.
Not the window, just the frame. Those are two fairly expensive items that we have to go through later on. It won't be till next summer. The rest of the workaround is slowly coming together. I still feel that we need a roof over this door if we're going to continue using it, so the snow doesn't come down and send somebody down on their face off the steps. The same with this door down here. Things break the snow up when it comes off the roof, so it doesn't come down in one big clump. But there are pieces up there that if you happen to go up there when the sun was shining, the piece might come down. So we got to look at that, figure out some way that we're going to attach a roof to it so that the snow doesn't fall on anybody. Because by the way things are with COVID, we may be using this entrance for a long time. So I think we've got to look at doing something with that. Whether it gets done through the winter or not depends on how bad a winter gets from now on. But next spring, we definitely look at those two projects. But other than that, everything is starting to come together. We haven't got all the figures in yet, but hopefully we'll have them all for the meeting in March. So anyway, that's the way it goes. Thank you.
Thank you, Will. Appreciate that. By the way, happy Valentine's Day, everybody. I hope you have a nice day today with your family and whoever you're with us today. Shall we worship? Let's open to our call to worship this morning, God's love. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love is of God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us.
He sent his one and only Son into the world, that we might live in him.
This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us.
He sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought to love one another.
If we love one another, God is in us. Love is made complete in us.
We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit.
If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God.
God is love.
Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him.
Father God, this morning we come in praise and adoration to worship this God that we love and whom we serve. We thank you for your presence here and continue to pray for your Spirit to be present in us and in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Join with me as we sing together, Come We That Love the Lord. By the way, just a correction in the bulletin, we're not going to do the refrain.
Thank you.
Well, you want the other one?
Yeah, we do the other one too. Wonderful story. This is a new one. At this time, we have our offering and our song, and we did leave out that element. Providing for us and remembering that, Father, we give out of our resources and out of the good blessings.
blessings that you've given to us, and thank you for the opportunity you give to ministry to bring honor and glory to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Is there any prayer requests that anybody has that we should know about to be aware of?
Well, when I was talking to Carol Hope a couple weeks ago, and her sister and her sister-in-law are both battling cancer.
Who again?
Carol Hope's sister and sister-in-law are both battling cancer.
Yes. Carol's sister just had a pretty major surgery on the end of this past week, and Charles' sister had had surgery too, yes.
Try and say a prayer for one of the electricians that was here. He cut his finger quite bad over the other day. He cut some tendons on him. He cut two fingers really, but he cut some tendons in one finger, and he has to have some plastic surgery.
So bad. You were there when that happened?
Oh, I was a doctor. I told him to give me his MSI number so he could pay me, but he never
did. What's his name?
Can't remember.
I can't remember.
Just call him Boy.
Boy. God knows.
Okay.
And Chris, how's he doing? Or Chester. Chester.
Oh, he's doing just fine. He's out of isolation today.
Okay, and he has his appointment coming up as well.
Yes, he does. We couldn't have prayers for Judy Dory. She's lived in Davenport for a number of years, and she's turning the air.
Okay. And you want to?
I'm just wondering if anybody knew from Roland's family. He was in the hospital.
I called Joanne this week, and she said that he's still in hospital, and it's kind of up in the air between the staff whether he's going to come home early or he's going to be there for a while. So it's kind of up in the air right now. And, remember Joanne as well. David is not well, so that's another person that we can be praying for. Sure. All right. Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Shall we worship God? Father, so good to be here. Great to have all who are here this morning as we come into your presence and acknowledge you as the God of all creation. We bless your name today and are so thankful for the privilege that is ours to gather when many are not able to. Father, sometimes it's good to be small. I know that many churches who are large are still not able to meet. We know the churches in the States are still closed, many of them. So, Father, thank you so much for this gathering. And Father, I pray that you help us to navigate through this. We've been so used to hugging one another, so used to connecting in conversation with one another. And we've been such a touchy-feely group of people. I just really felt and missed that part of our relationship. And I can just continue to pray for each one here as we navigate these our relationship and not being able to hug and to share in the same way. Father, we are just grateful to be in this place again and ask that you not only be present here, but as a springboard into our week, and to thank you for all that you provide. Thanking you for this past week and all the good things that you've brought away. Jesus, you have called us to abide in you so that you can abide in us. And just as you said, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can we unless we abide in you today. Father, you remind us that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And we will say of you, O Lord, you are our refuge, you are our fortress, you are our God in whom we will trust. Therefore, we draw near to you, O God. And Father, we know that faith comes from hearing the message that is spoken today. It is heard through your word. To that end, Father, I pray that you would open our minds. thoughts of God this morning, to hear what you are wanting to say to us. Arise and shine your light, for it is come, and your glory rests on each one here. We rejoice and pray without ceasing, and in everything we give you thanks, as this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. Father, today we trust in you with all our hearts, leaning not on our own understanding, but in all our ways we acknowledge you, so that you might direct our paths. Your name, O Lord, is a strong tower, and the righteous are running to it and are safe. May our love not be fake, O God. May we hate what is evil and cling to what is good. Help us to make the best use of our time. May we redeem the time in which we live, because this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. So we thank you, God, that you committed your love toward us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Father, may the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you today. And we give you thanks for your love and loving us so much that you gave your only Son. And greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And because we can cast all our care on you and you care for us, Father, we lift up Carolyn's sister, Debbie. We lift up Charles' sister as well as they recuperate from surgery. We're reminded of this electrician, can't remember, and ask that you know his name and that you take care of him and that you restore those fingers that have been injured. And Father, we think of Chester too as he comes out of isolation and he gets ready for his doctor's appointment. May you just take care of him. Father, we remember Roland today, also thinking of David Harris and Joanne too, remembering all of them as you care for them, and also Judy Dory. One thing that I know, Father, for sure, is that when we pray in the name of Jesus and the full authority that you give us, we can lift these people up to you and know you hear our prayers for them. May you be the God of all comfort. May you be a blessing on them. May the power of your Holy Spirit raise them to life and to renew their health in Jesus' name. Father, as we have been thinking about love today and Valentine's Day, may we remember the importance of unconditional love, not just today, but throughout the year. May we, again, overcome evil with good. As we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Time we have our scripture, our musical presentation. Mary, thank you for being here today.
Thank you. scripture is from Psalm 125. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Sinai, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people, both now and forevermore. The scepter of the wicked will not remain over the land allotted to the righteous. For then the righteous might use their hands to do evil. Lord, do good to those who are good, to those who are upright in heart. But those who turn to crooked ways, the Lord will banish with the evil doers. Peace be on Israel. Also, reading from John 10, that's not in your bulletin, but that's okay. John 10, starting at verse 22, reading through until verse 29. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts, walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered around him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me. But you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand." May God bless the reading of His word.
Thank you, Linda. Powerful words in times like these. In elementary school, I've had my grandchildren come home and talk about patterns. And can you guys give me a pattern? What's a pattern? Give me an example of a pattern.
A design.
Pardon me?
A design.
Okay, well give me examples
two, four,
of a pattern.
2, 4, 6, 8.
2, 4, 6, 8.
Checker.
Yes.
Flat.
Circle, a square, a triangle, circle, square, a triangle, circle, square, a triangle. That's a pattern, right? Well, the Songs of Ascent are a pattern. They're divided into five sections with three patterns. And it goes like this: trouble, trust, and truth. Psalm 120 started with trouble, Psalm 21 with trust, and Psalm 123 with triumph. Psalm 124, no, did I get that right? 20, 21, 22. Now 23 was trouble, 24 was trust, and today we're going to talk about triumph. There's the pattern. So here's my question. Do you ever worry?
Never.
Do you ever worry about the future?
Yes.
This is yes. Right, yeah. So a lot of people do, even me. They're afraid of what might happen to them, or to their fortunes, or to their families, or whatever it is. They might be afraid of what happens to the world, so I advise you not to listen to the news. Whenever you feel unsettled or insecure, Psalm 125 is your go-to. John chapter 10, verses 22 to 28 can be your go-to. This is a triumph psalm. It is also one of the songs of Zion, Does anybody know what the word Zion refers to? I love preaching because I can teach you so much, right? Zion is talking about Jerusalem. And the theme of today's psalm is really about safety and security. How many women like being secure? Most women like that. Guys, we need to do a better job sometimes. But safety and security, very important. Anyway, in the sum of the sense, Ray Fowler says that these psalms are stepping stones to God's heart. And they lead us closer to God and His heart. I don't know about you, but I really like to know how to get closer to God's heart. And leading us closer to God's heart, they're showing God's people are as safe and as secure as Mount Zion, surrounded by other mountains. Of course, if you go to Jerusalem, remember, from everywhere you are coming to Jerusalem, you're always going uphill. But there's also mountains all around Jerusalem. Psalm 22 mentions it, Psalm 25, and then the rest of the Psalms are just filled with this theme of Mount Zion or Zion. And Psalm 25 focuses on the geography of Jerusalem to show the security of God's people. What a great song to be singing for these people who in seven festivals would go to Jerusalem. Three that I mentioned are Passover, Pentecost, and the Feast of Tabernacles in the fall. Zion is a specific historical place located in Israel. The name refers to both hills in the city of Jerusalem and to the city itself, but it is also a general name and has a general meaning, referring to a holy place or the kingdom of heaven. Those are very, very significant when you think about that, and every time now that you read that, it is a holy place. It is literally the kingdom of heaven. Peter says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone." Lost my place. He says, "A chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." Peter goes on to say, Christ is that cornerstone. And when you trust in him, you will never be put to shame. You see, many people drift away. Jesus is the cornerstone. What is a cornerstone anyway? I see there's one out here. It's kind of what the final brick that kind of goes into a building and solidifies it. Jesus is that foundation. He's the cornerstone of that foundation. And when we build our life on Christ and his words, we are on solid ground. And when we build our life in this way, we are like literally Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken, but endures, it says, for how long? Pardon me?
Forever.
I always like you guys talking to me. It's always nice to... Yeah, absolutely, forever. We need to hear that. W.H.J. Page writes, "Some persons are like the sand, ever shifting and treacherous. Some are like the sea, restless and unsettled. Some are like the wind, uncertain and not constant. Believers are like a mountain. Strong, stable, and secure." Jesus said this about his followers, "I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them from my hands," just as Linda read. If your faith is in Christ this morning, folks, you are safe and secure. You are like Mount Zion from Psalm 125. Which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. That is our mantra. That is what we hold on to. That is our meditation as we worship today. I don't know what your life is like. I don't know what's happening for you all the time. But I can let you know for sure that as Mount Zion, we can be safe and we can be secure. Because three things we know in this Psalm 125 is that those who trust in the Lord are safe and secure. And those who trust in the Lord have a secure inheritance. And those who trust in the Lord have a secure future, no matter what's happening in our world or in our own personal lives. And these verses tell us that what you and I are like when we trust in the Lord. And they tell us what the Lord is like to you when we trust in Him. These are things that I need to be learning all the time and need to be reminded of all the time. You are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. The Lord surrounds you on every side. No matter what is assailing you, we need to be understanding that in our own personal lives. I'd like to share with you some things that I, in a study by a lady by the name of Brittany Yesudasan. I think that's how you say her name. But here's the thing. We talked about trust. But what is that? What does that kind of mean? How do I get a handle on that? How do I kind of tenaciously hold on to that and understand it in my life today? Obviously, Psalm 125 was written a long time ago. John's Gospel was written over 2,000 years ago. You see, life is not predictable. We all pretty well know that. Every day we get up, we're not quite sure how the day is going to roll up, correct? So there's ups, there's downs, and many of us want to trust God. And it's easy to do that when times are good, right? But it's a whole lot harder when life is hard. You know, I'm dealing with my mom who has memory challenges. You know, we're dealing with some things in our own personal life that can be challenging. And there are days, you know, especially when we're tired, especially when we have one nerve left and someone's standing on it. You know what I mean? You know? How do you trust God then when you feel like your ground is kind of uncertain? That's what I'm talking about. God's unchanging character is what gives us a firm foundation when things feel so unsteady and so uncertain. That's what I need to remind myself all the time. It needs to be repeated not only in my life, but in yours as well. Life can be going along smoothly for a season, and we have been living relatively safe in our world today until COVID. Then all of a sudden, life throws a curveball. Someone you know gets sick. People lose their jobs. COVID-19. Friends have been diagnosed with cancer. Things you felt that were secure are all of a sudden shaky and uncertain. You know, we're literally shocked so many times by the things that happen. And so, what do we do? What do we do? So, here's what I know. God cannot lie. He always keeps His promises. Trusting Him means believing what He says about Himself, about the world, and about you. And that everything He says about all of that is true. Trusting in Him means believing what He says about Himself, about the world. Trusting Him is more than a feeling. Because I tell you, if I trusted my feelings, I would be all over the map. It's a choice to have faith, folks, in what He says, even when my feelings and my circumstances would have me believe something different. Your feelings and circumstances, I agree, matter. They're worth paying attention to. God cares about those things. But we don't
base our belief and our life on Him. And we know those things can change any moment. God does not change. He is the same as you've heard yesterday, today, and forever. Trusting God is not about ignoring your feelings or the reality. It's not pretending that everything is okay when it isn't. Trusting God is living a life of belief in obedience to God, even when it's difficult, even when it's hard, even when you feel like throwing in the towel, when it doesn't make sense. Read Habakkuk. It's only 3 chapters. Pretty easy. He was a prophet, but he's known as the complaining prophet. He never prophesied anything. He just simply complained to God about his life situation. As he saw Judah coming to its end, as Babylon was coming, and he was saying to God, "Why are you doing this to us? Babylon, after all, is worse than we are." But at the end, as he comes to the end of his complaint to God, he says, "Even though there are no crops in the fields, grapes on the vine, sheep in the pen, cattle in the stall, when I've got nothing, yet will I put my trust, my faith in you." Folks, when the bottom falls out of your life, will you be able to say like Habakkuk, "Though there is nothing, yet will I praise you"? That is where the rubber meets the road. But here's the thing. How do I do that? How in the world can I do that? Well, here's some things that I would like to give you as suggestions. As now that you know what it means to trust in God, if you trust someone, you feel comfortable being honest with them about anything. And God is much more reliable than we think. And even your most trustworthy friends are not as good as Him. We need to cast all our care, all our anxiety on Him, Peter said, because He cares for us. He keeps track of all our sorrows. You have collected, the psalmist says, all my tears in your bottle. You have recorded each and every one of them in your book. And you see, because God loves you and me, you can show your trust in Him by simply sharing everything with Him. Talking about your feelings and your circumstances, the good and the hard, as you pray. That's what we need to do, is to pray. Talk to Him about some of those challenges. Don't let your emotions rule your life. Bring them to God so He can help you address them. He is not disappointed, it says, or frustrated by your struggles, doubts, or pain. He cares about you, and you can trust Him with those things. And when you trust Him, you go to God and His Word when life is hard. Folks, that is our source, the Word of God, prayer, two of the significant things that we can do as we connect. As we pray this morning, guess where I got the prayers? Scripture. The Word of God. They came right from there. What better thing to do than to pray the Word? And so, when you trust, you go to the Word, when life is hard, and you act out of obedience, doing what God says in His Word. Paul did it so well as he found himself in prison and wrote the book of Philippians, or the letter to the Philippians. "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice." How can a guy do that in a prison like that? And yet, he became the example. But guess what? I know that we won't do it perfectly. There will be hard days, and sometimes it will be very difficult. But God is good. Jesus is our perfect example of that. He said this, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here." Who do you say that to? "Stay here and keep watch." Who did he say that to? Who? Which three?
Peter, James,
and John. I can't.
can't hear you well.
I have a hearing aid, so I need help. What did he say?
Peter, James, and John.
Thank you. Peter, James, and John. Absolutely. Peter, James, and John. And he said, going a little further, he fell to the ground and he prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from me. What hour is he talking about?
Crucifixion.
The crucifixion. That's right. And so, Abba, Father, he says, Dad. That's literally what he said. He said, Daddy, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. So here is the Son of God struggling, overwhelmed with his circumstances and his situation, not having a struggle trying to hold on. And he has three disciples. Please watch it with me. And he goes to his Father and he says these words. And so, he cares for our hurts. He pays attention. That, for me, is comfort. To know that the God of the universe is also paying attention to you and to me. Knowing that God is for you will strengthen you in your trust as you read the Word and are made confident through what it says during times of hardship and times when we don't know what the future holds. So, we seek Scripture. We pray. We confess unbelief. I got to tell you, I struggle with my faith. But I'm not alone. Because when Jesus came down from the Mount of Transfiguration, there was a father with a son. And the disciples had been trying to release a demon from him, and they couldn't do it. And Jesus comes, and He does that, but before he does, the Father says, Jesus says, do you believe? He said, yes, I believe. Help me with my unbelief. So, we're not alone. And so, it's good to acknowledge that his character is good and trustworthy, that we can agree with him, that all he says is true, and that even when I find it hard to believe, he still is faithful. Mark 9, that's the story. But not only that, share your concerns with community. You know, that's what we did in prayer. I asked you, who do you know that we could be praying for? And you shared some people. You shared with Chester and others. We can pray for one another. We can share our concerns. Sometimes when we find it hard to believe, it's good to put your hand in the hand of one who does. And so sharing our concerns with one another, our church and faith community, can be pretty important. And he said, Paul, in his lifetime, he shared, I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. He saw the significance of his ministry and work was simply partnering with all those fellow believers and disciples in Christ. And so when you are struggling, share the concerns with another follower of Jesus, obviously who you trust, not somebody who's going to tell the whole world. You understand? So, some of you know is pursuing a relationship with God regularly and knows God's Word, and you can share your struggles and to tell them. And not only that, but we remember God and spend time with Him, which is in prayer. God is bigger than our circumstances. We need to cast all our care on Him because He cares for us. Cast your burden on the Lord, and He will lift you up. That's our confidence as we spend regular time with God. And so, not only that, but we need to look to look at our situation and circumstances, but be grateful. Have an attitude of gratitude. Be thankful. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God. In everything that's happening, give thanks to God. Be grateful. I'm so grateful. At least I have somewhat of a warm hose. Sometimes when I'm in it, it feels a little cold. When I go outside, come back in, it seems a lot warmer. You know? But just even in the little things, many people today may not have enough income to keep them through the winter. There may be other people who are struggling, not just financially, but physically, mentally, whatever. Be grateful for all those little things, and we need to remember that. Rejoice always, again, pray, you know, Paul said, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will concerning you. Because what happens when you give thanks, it changes your mindset. It moves from the negative to the positive. That which you think about, you bring about. So as you bring about thanksgiving, you bring joy into your life, no matter what's happening. So, walk in the Spirit. Folks, one of the things that I have learned and continuing to learn is that every day I get up and pray that God's Spirit fills me, because that is the person that gives me the energy not only to live in my day, but get through my day, but to enjoy my day. So the Holy Spirit lives in each and every one of us who trusts in Jesus Christ, both as Savior and Lord, and He is the constant helper, always pointing us to Jesus. And so, the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, Jesus said, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. And the Spirit brings comfort. And we need, and this is something that we're learning these days, we need to wait on the Lord. In the instant pudding society in which we live in, we always want it yesterday. We do not like to wait. One day, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, 5 years. But sometimes it is simply having to wait on the Lord because of the lessons that He wants to teach us. As we wait on the Lord, we may learn patience. We might learn humility. We might learn grace. We might learn compassion that we would not have learned had we have gotten instant gratification. And so it's learning to wait on the Lord. And the Holy Spirit will lead you to what you should do. And what sometimes we need to do is wait. That. We wanted that today. So, they who wait on the Lord, it says, shall renew their strength. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. These are the spiritual exercises that we need to do as we understand the safety and security that God brings us. God is never neglecting your life or mine. He is simply exposing us to what is expected to happen in our world, trouble and challenges. But we learn that in trouble we can trust, and in that trust we can be experience triumph. And that is something that we all need to learn. Even when our trust falters, we can, again, come to Him, because God is trustworthy. He loves us unconditionally. His mercy never changes. It never fails. His compassion is new every morning. Great is His faithfulness to you and me. That is our hope, because He realizes that we are made of dust. So as we wait and trust and remember that God loves us, we can trust Him to sustain us and provide for us. I think that's what the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, were experiencing as they made their trek to Jerusalem every year and sang these songs. It gave them that new sense of vigor and vitality, so to speak, as we connected with God. So in closing, not only that, we have a secure inheritance. Well, what is that inheritance anyway? Our inheritance, folks, is imperishable. What we have in Christ is not subject to corruption or decay. It's absolutely wonderful to know that. Our inheritance in Christ is unspoiled. Here on earth, things decay, rot, die. But what we have in Christ is free from anything that would be deformed, debased, degraded, and turned into nothing. Nothing on earth, you see, is perfect. It's not going to last. Even the most beautiful things of this world are flawed. Christ is truly perfect, unspoiled. That inheritance waiting for us. Our inheritance is unfading. We have in Christ, or what we have in Christ, is an enduring possession. And as creatures of the world, it is hard for us to imagine colors that will fade, excitement that never flags, or value that never depreciates. But this inheritance is unfading, never depreciating. And finally, our inheritance is in Christ is reserved. It is waiting for you and me. This life is simply a pilgrimage. This is not home. And so as we put our faith in Jesus Christ today, in spite of the situations,
we know that we can be safe and secure not only in this life, but in the life to come. That is the hope of these Psalms of Ascent. And we are God's people. So, if your faith is in Christ, then you are safe and secure. Just as Jesus said, no one will be able to snatch them from my hands. You literally, like the psalmist in 125 said, you are like Mount Zion, the holy place, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever. You understand in Christ, you endure forever. As the mountains surrounding Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds you on every side. If your faith is in Christ, then your inheritance is secure. The power of the wicked will not be broken on the outside, and the power of sin will be broken on the inside. Your inheritance is kept safe from the wicked, and you are kept safe to receive it. And if your faith is in Christ, then your future is secure. You have been made good in Christ through his blood and his sacrifice. And God will do good to those who are good. Pray if your faith in Christ, if your faith is in Christ, then you are safe. You are secure. And once more, trust means a firm belief in the reality, truth, ability, strength of someone or something. And our someone is Jesus. Have you put your faith in him? I don't know what you're going through today, but I pray that this message might be God's word to you today, to give you hope, to give you life, to give you peace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn as we close today. I have a good friend, actually, in Cumming, Georgia. He connects all the way from Cumming, Georgia to our services. He says, pray for us for Herman Heisel, for family and friends of Mike Gravel, who passed away recently. So, again, praying as a community. Let's just pray. Father, today we want to lift up Herman Heisel and remember his friend, family and friends of Mike Gravel, who just passed away recently. May you cover them with your love and the filling of your spirit and comfort in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Carol. Starting, my Jesus, I love you. Thank you.
pray again that you experience God's safety and security this week as you turn to Him through any of the challenges you might face. And I leave you with this, especially in this Valentine's Day. May God's love surround you, God's Spirit guide you, God's whisper cheer you, God's peace calm you, God's shield protect you, God's wisdom arm you, wherever God may lead you. Love you guys. Have a great week.